The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Hey, this is John Hanna, and you're listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show.
SWJ, if you please. Sir Walter Jones. Who that? Who that? Sir Walter Jones.
Oh, yeah.
Sir Walter Jones.
Come on, come on.
Sir Walter Jones.
Put them hands up.
Sir Walter Jones.
Hey, you know that.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who we listening to?
The Sir Walter Jones Show.
Yeah, I know that's right.
This is the Sir Walter Jones Show with co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show that tackles the hot topics in a believer's walk. Get in on the conversation now by calling 773-675-5906. Sir Walter Jones. Sir Walter Jones.
Come on, everybody.
Sir Walter Jones.
Let's do it one time.
Sir Walter Jones.
Ladies.
Sir Walter Jones.
Fellas.
Sir Walter Jones.
We're listening to
the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Yeah, I know that's right.
Proverbs 18 and 10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and is safe. Got a question about scriptures? Well, we got the answers. Just ask the elders. It's Theology Thursday, right here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Thursday.
Hello, everybody out there. So welcome to the Sir Walter Jones Show. I am here. It is Wednesday. Nope, Thursday. Thursday. Theology Thursday. It is a day we sit around the mic and talk about the Bible. The B-I-B-L-E, man, that's the book for me. It is an instructional manual to our lives, day to day, not just month. Every single day, every hour. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that man should always pray and not faint. We should always be seeking the Lord. We should always have our minds focused on Him. And then when this happens, He will keep us in perfect peace. Today's show is talking about the power of repentance. The power of repentance. Why did I say power? Because there's something that happens after a man repents. Now, after he repents, truly repents. We're going to talk about the counterfeits of repentance as well. We have the great Pastor Estelle Keeter and her lovely daughter, Marilyn Keeter, will be coming in at 4:30, just a few minutes from now. But I want to set the house straight with some teaching for the next first 30 minutes so that I can help y'all understand this whole thing about repentance. I think it was just perfect to do a show on repentance in January. Why not? The first week of my show is kicking off the 2016 year. I think it's important because so many things have happened to us in America due to our not wanting to repent. Believe it or not, God is still active in our lives and in the lives of our nation and in the world. People think he's silent, he doesn't care anymore, or he's just waiting for people to do stuff. Well, the latter is true. He is waiting for us to do things. Okay, he's waiting and he's waiting patiently because he is a very patient God. But then there are some actions of us. We do some things and then God strikes. Okay, how he strikes depends on who you are. All right, there are some people who can do an act, an evil act, and God will wait to bring down judgment on that person. The next person right next to you can do an evil act, and God will react right away. He will answer that transgression right away. It depends on who you are to the Lord. It depends on your relationship with God. It depends on His instructions to you. Okay. So there's some people who look like it seems like they're getting away with all kind of evil. God sees all. He knows all. And he deals with them in his own time. So just because he has not answered doesn't mean he didn't answer, because a non-answer is an answer. I just confused all of you. Today's show will not be a show where thousands of people will tune in because it's talking about repentance. Trust me. If I was talking about music, scandal, how to get away with murder, sex appeal, how to get a man in 30 days or less, man, y'all be chiming in like crazy. But this is a show about repentance, something that for so many, it's not easy to do because you're not through with some things that you want to take care of. I get that. Man, I do understand. I'm going to go well around. I'm going to try to cover every aspect of this life of repentance and see if we can delve into this, because it seems to me I come up under a fire and brimstone type teaching in my church. Not the present church I'm in, but coming up as a boy, I heard it all. And most of the sermons about sin was about sex. Sex, sex, and more sex. You hussies, you harlots, you whores, you prostitutes, you, let me see, sissies, and gays, homos. It all had to deal with sex, sexual sins, fornication, adultery, anything dealing with that, lasciviousness and all that stuff. You heard it from the Bible, from the fire and brimstone preacher. But there's some things he missed out that he did not spend a whole lot of time on, because those things seem to be hidden, but they are so much more present than just the little sexual sins that men commit against their own bodies. The lying and deception. Many of these abominable acts that men do, we don't talk about those things. We will today. And one of the worst is sowing discord among brethren. There you are in the pulpit preaching against everybody's sin, but yet you just exposed everybody's sin. Meaning, Sister Bobo just told you last night about an indiscretion, and then you decide to wait till you get to the pulpit to talk about this indiscretion, and she told you this is in secret. And then people who know who you're talking about call Sister Bobo that night, and then somebody calls somebody, and then somebody, you're sowing all of this discord among your own body, because God didn't tell you to speak openly about a discretion. When prophets come to me, I sometimes have to stop and say, wait, hold up. You're on the microphone. Did God tell you to do this on the microphone, or should you be in my ear right now? I'm bold enough to ask him that, because that's important. Sometimes what we do is we go over the microphone in our churches because we want, what it does is builds us up. Okay. It builds us up and makes us look like, you know, we ruffle our feathers in front of everybody to show our authority. From the Lord. God told me to tell you. Well, he told you to tell me, not the whole generation that's sitting up here. Okay. Now what you're getting ready to tell me, now these people think, you know, somebody prophesied to me that I was going to get $30,000 in 30 days over the microphone. I wish he told me that in secret. Because for the next 30 days, everybody was counting down, and they were spending my money for me.
Wow.
Hey, man, you got 5 more days. Is that money come here? And when it come, can you lend me? I said, you know what? And that was several years ago, by the way, and that money never came. Okay, I got the great Annette Harris here. She's going to do some reading for me for the next 30 minutes, and then she's going to move out of the way and let the Keeters do their thing, all right? You ain't offended. You got your own show.
Yes, I sure do.
Hey, go to Isaiah chapter 1 and let's see if we can go into this thing, because this is God speaking to Israel. He's speaking, actually, this is a judgment towards Judah. We know about Judah, the northern kingdom, southern kingdom, Israel and Judah, those two, and all of those crooked kings and many mixed in with those great kings. We did a show on it already. Okay, Judah was messed up. And it was Judah. It was that story where the man had brought his concubine to a house, and the men came because they wanted to have sex with the men. And he said, here, take this woman. and they had their way with that woman. Remember that story? Mm-hmm. And they raped her all night long, and then until the morning time, when she finally crawled her way back to the house. And when he opened the door, he found her dead. He said, come on, let's go. And she was dead, and he chopped her body up in 12 pieces. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's Judah. Okay. Mm-hmm. All right, so let's go to Isaiah. I'm stuck on Judah. Judah means praise, by the way.
Yes, it does.
And guess who come out of Judah? Christ Jesus.
That's right.
Absolutely. So you can't destroy Judah altogether. That's Christ's brothers and sisters right there. Mm-hmm. Judah 1, what did it say?
Isaiah.
Mm-hmm. What Judah 1 say?
Oh, I'm sorry. Would you like which version? NLT?
Yeah, that's fine. Okay.
Isaiah 1 and 1.
Because I can correct the mistakes in the King James. Go ahead. What did you say?
Interesting. These are the visions that Isaiah, son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. Mm. He saw these visions during the years when Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah were kings of Judah. Mm-hmm. Listen, O heavens. Pay attention, earth. This is what the Lord says. The children I raised and cared for have rebelled against me.
The children he raised.
Mm-hmm.
And he cared for them.
Yes.
Have your children ever gone against you after all the good things that you've done for them? This is America. This is the Pentecostal church. This is many of the Jews, my Jewish friends, okay, the Hebrew friends. These are a lot, many of you out there. This is God speaking to you. Y'all have turned on this man, on this God, on our Father. Uh-huh. Keep going.
Even an ox knows its owner.
Mm.
And a donkey recognizes its master's care.
An ass understands his own master and how he cares for him.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
But
what?
Israel doesn't know its master.
You're worse than an ass. Yes, I said it. You are... That's what he's saying here. He says an ass understands it, but you don't understand it. Does that make you worse than an ass? Yes. Continue.
My people don't recognize my care for them.
Yeah.
Oh, what a sinful nation they are. Mm. Loaded down with a burden of guilt. They are evil people, corrupt children who have rejected the Lord. They have despised the Holy One of Israel and turned their backs on him.
Good Lord. That's a lot.
Why do you continue to invite punishment? Must you rebel forever? Your head is injured and your heart is sick.
Your head is injured.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the head is injured, guess what? The whole body is going to hurt.
That's right.
Uh-huh.
You are battered from head to foot.
Wow.
Covered with bruises, welts, and infected wounds.
Mm.
Without any soothing ointments or bandages. Your country lies in ruins.
You ever been sick?
Yes.
And there was no medicine around?
Mm-hmm.
You ever cut yourself? Mm-hmm. You had wounds or what have you, but you just couldn't bandage it up?
Mm-hmm.
You said that's the state that they were in.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Your country lies in ruins, and your towns are burned. Foreigners plunder your fields before your eyes
and
destroy everything they see.
United States.
Mm-hmm.
That's coming. The foreigners are coming.
Yes.
They're going to plunder and wreak and they're going to gather up the spoil.
Mm-hmm.
The booties of war, I think they call it. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. They're gathering up. Get ready. It's coming.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Beautiful Jerusalem stands abandoned like a watchman's shelter in a vineyard, like a lean-to in a cucumber field after the harvest, like a helpless city under siege.
Mm.
If the Lord of Heaven's armies had not spared a few of us, we would have been wiped out like Sodom. Destroyed like Gomorrah.
Except there'd be a remnant here left in the United States. Of just a few people, just a few of God's saints who could preach the gospel.
Mm-hmm.
Just a few of them. And then the effect of Gideon's army will come to pass.
Mm-hmm.
Because God is not impressed with numbers. You don't need it. Because then the people will say, we did this.
Right.
So God says, chop that army down. Because I want the people to know. The enemy to know that I did this, which is a few people. So God uses remnants heavily.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Listen to the Lord, you leaders of Sodom. Listen to the law of our God, people of Gomorrah. What makes you think I want all your sacrifices, said the Lord?
Here goes. You in church. We bring a sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. Mm-hmm. All right? Mm-hmm. And he looking at you Monday through Saturday. Mm-mm. And he says, what makes you think I want that? Mm. Keep going.
I am sick of your burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fattened cattle. Yeah. I get no pleasure from the blood of bulls and lambs and goats.
All of you guys. Now, you know, this is the rituals of, this is Old Testament. So, you know, there's blood sacrifice going on for the remission of sin. There's mm-hmm. no remission except the shedding of blood. So that's what's going on here. Mm-hmm. That part of the law has been overturned. We don't have to do that anymore. Well, we didn't have to do it. This is the Hebrews. They did it. But
right.
Christ came in place of this. All right. But yet we still give sacrifices of praise. In the house. Our body's supposed to be a sacrifice. Okay.
Yes.
A living sacrifice, mm-hmm. that is. All right. So, but unfortunately, if you want to bring this into today, God's not pleased with the offerings that we give.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, continue.
When you come to worship me,
mm-hmm.
who asked you to parade through my courts with all your ceremony?
Who told you to march in the choir Sunday morning and the elders come in with the with the collars and on one accord, taking an hour to come down there. He says, I ain't tell you to do that. mm-hmm. With the frankincense and stuff. Yeah.
Why are we doing it? Mm-hmm. Stop bringing me your meaningless gifts.
I don't want any gifts.
The incense of your offerings disgusts me.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
As for your celebrations of the new moon and the Sabbath.
New moons.
And your special days for fasting.
Those of you who celebrate the new moons mm-hmm. and the Sabbath day. Whether it's Saturday, well, it is Saturday for those of you who don't know what day it is. But you Constantinians, you do it on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you Romans out there. Okay, I get that. He says, but whatever.
Mm-hmm.
What did he say?
They are all sinful and yeah. false.
And he said, I don't even want it.
I want no more of your pious meetings.
Wow, y'all got more meetings in church than anybody I know. You got 5 members, but y'all have 20 members of meetings, that is. Uh-huh.
I hate your new moon celebrations and your annual festivals.
Every year you got pastor's anniversary, church anniversary, deacon's anniversary, usher's anniversary,
mm-hmm.
choir anniversary. You open the garage door. That's an anniversary. Okay. Your annual affairs. He says, I'm tired of it. I don't need any of that stuff.
Mm-hmm. They are a burden to me.
Burdened.
I cannot stand them.
Mm.
When you lift up your hands in prayer.
What?
I will not look.
Look at me, God. Look at me. I'm using these big words before the people of God. And you want God to see it. He mm-hmm. says, I'm not even looking at it. Mm-hmm. He got his hands. You know how the monkey see no evil, hear no evil?
Speak no evil. Right.
That's what I'm looking at God. That's, he got his hands over his eyes. Uh-huh.
Mm-mm-mm. Though you offer many prayers,
yeah.
I will not listen.
Yeah, we're having a prayer meeting. Okay.
For your hands are covered with the blood of innocent victims.
You shed a lot of blood like David did.
Mm-hmm.
Blood shedders. That's what we are. Yes. Uh-huh.
Wash yourselves and be clean.
Okay. Now you go. Go wash up. You're nasty.
Mm.
Yeah.
Get your sins out of my sight.
Put away those evil doings. Mm-hmm.
Give up your evil ways.
Mm-hmm.
Learn to do good.
Seek judgment.
Seek justice.
Mm-hmm.
Help the oppressed. Defend the cause of orphans.
The fatherless.
Fight for the rights of widows.
Plead for the widows. This is true religion here.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 16 should shout out in the streets. You guys are captured in church all day long, shouting and speaking in tongues, foaming, laying hands with each other, eating chicken dinners all day Sunday. But nobody know who you are Monday through Saturday.
Mm-mm-mm.
You don't go visit the sick. You don't go to the jails. You don't serve at the soup kitchens. You don't clothe nobody. You don't even take any clothes and take it down to the, what's that army?
Salvation.
Okay.
See, what's that,
that is an army. You don't do none of that. And so the world don't know who you are. Okay. Because when you go in church, you close the door and lock it. Some of your churches lock the door, literally. So 16 should, this is what impresses God. What does not impress God is what you do on Sunday mornings with all of that stuff. Now, I'm not telling you to stop doing it because I go to church faithfully every Sunday. Mm-hmm. I do all those things. But you have to read this in context. He's giving you an if factor.
Yeah.
You get it?
Mm-hmm.
It's a contrast. He's telling you, I don't want none of that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Until, you see what I'm saying? All right. Keep reading.
Come now.
Mm-hmm.
Let's settle this, says the Lord.
Let's reason together.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Though your sins are like scarlet, I will make them as white as snow.
You know what color scarlet is?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Red.
It sure is red.
Yes, it is.
That's how your sins are. They're red. It's crimson.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Though they are red like crimson,
mm-hmm.
I will make them as white as wool.
Yeah, white as snow, and there shall be wool as well.
Mm-hmm.
White as snow, white as wool.
Yes.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
If you will only obey me,
yeah.
You will have plenty to eat.
Mm-hmm. You'll be eating good.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But if you turn away
mm-hmm.
and refuse to listen,
mm-hmm.
you will be devoured by the sword of your enemies.
Wow, the enemies are coming, and God will allow them to come and take care of you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I, the Lord, have spoken.
Yeah.
See how Jerusalem, once so faithful, has become a prostitute. Do you want to continue? Or?
He said, y'all became a prostitute.
Mm.
Israel. And Jesus mentioned that, too. He says, you guys are adulterous and adulteresses.
Mm-hmm.
He wasn't talking about man sleeping with a woman.
Right.
He's talking about spiritually.
Mm-hmm.
You're serving the devil as well as trying to serve the Lord. You can't, you know, then there goes the bitter and sweet fountain.
Mm-hmm.
I like to see that fountain. Yeah, never seen that kind of fountain.
Yes. Yeah. Contrast.
Yeah, I don't understand that. Okay.
Yeah.
Keep reading.
Once the home of justice and righteousness,
mm-hmm.
she is now filled with murderers.
Murderers. Uh-huh.
Once like pure silver, you have become like worthless slag.
Man, who talks to you like that? I mean, what father out there talks to their children like that?
Right.
But this is God saying, you know, I'm going to beat you.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, this is going to hurt me.
Mm-hmm.
Worse than it hurts you.
Yes.
That's what God's saying here. He's mm-hmm. hurt by the actions of his own children.
Yes.
And so don't bring me no gift
mm-hmm.
because I'm not accepting it. And this is that counterfeit praise that I'm going to talk about later on in the show.
Okay.
It's counterfeit.
Counterfeit.
Yeah. God loves a humble heart.
Mm-hmm.
He resists the proud,
mm-hmm.
but he gives grace to the humble. You know that.
Yes.
Keep reading.
Once so pure.
Yeah.
You are now like watered down wine.
I had wine and it tastes like water. And somebody said, don't keep drinking it because you don't taste the alcohol. Because if you keep drinking it, you're going to realize that you're going to start getting drunk because you're looking for the alcohol taste. Alcohol is going in your system.
Mm-hmm.
It just tastes like Kool-Aid. Mm-hmm. And that's how people get drunk so fast because they don't taste the alcohol right away.
Okay.
You ever wash clothes? And you got this cheap soap powder.
Mm-hmm.
But because you don't see the suds.
Soap powder.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
I'm from Mississippi.
Yes, you are.
When you don't see. Shout out to Demetra Triplett.
Wow.
Hey, Demetra. So when you you put the soap powder in the washing machine, mm-hmm. you turn it on and you don't see the suds.
Yes.
What do?
You put more in there.
Yep. And you keep putting more until you see suds.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what you've done is you put too much soap in
mm-hmm.
there. And you're flooding the whole ozone. Okay. And that's what's going on here. What you just read? Say it again.
Once pure like silver, you have become like worthless slag. Once so pure, you are now like watered down wine.
Watered down wine. Whew. Yeah. I remember giving a vision. I received a vision from the Lord. This was 2006, I think it was.
Mm-hmm.
I dream and I have visions. My dreams don't mean a hill of beans. A lot of them are just so silly. maybe about 2-3% of them mean something.
Your dreams?
My dreams.
Okay.
My visions, though, mm-hmm. I pay close attention to those. Mm-hmm. Because when I have a vision, usually somebody's involved in it, I have to go tell them the vision. And usually, bam, I'm right on point. Okay.
Okay.
But I remember having a vision, and I'll never forget it. I was teaching in South Dakota at a Catholic school.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I bought, the classrooms had blackboards. Some of them still had blackboards before the whiteboard thing came around.
Really?
Mm-hmm. You write on the whiteboard, okay, and you write, and then you, and so what you do is you tell the you tell one of the students, go and take the eraser. Remember back in the days, take the eraser, go wet it.
Oh, yeah.
Uh-huh, and then clean the blackboard.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So I was giving my class, and I went away to lunch, and I came back. Somebody had wrote profanity on the blackboard.
Wow.
And I told the student, now this is in the vision, I told the student, I erased it.
Mm-hmm.
But because the, and I have to remember how this vision went, actually, I didn't go for lunch. I went away for the rest of the day. So it was at the end of the day, and I left. Someone had wrote profanity on the board. And the next day, I came back at the end, towards the end of the day, and it was still there. And I told one of the kids, I erased it myself. But if chalk is on the board mm-hmm. long,
mm-hmm.
after a while, it leaves.
Stain.
Uh-huh. The impression is still there.
Mm-hmm.
Like some of the TV tubes of the back in the day. So I took the eraser and I erased it, but some of the wording was still there.
Mm-hmm.
And I told the kid, go wet it. And he brought it back and I wet the board and it was clean.
Mm-hmm.
And in the vision, this was the first part of the vision. The Lord was saying, your life is black.
Mm.
And it's so black that people are writing nasty things in your life.
Mm.
And so are you.
Mm.
And so go and have someone to wet that eraser. And when they did, it came back and he told me, look at the board. And it was nice and clean.
Mm-hmm.
I said, well, look at that.
Mm-hmm.
He said, but you're still black.
Mm.
So I went and bought a whiteboard for my class. All right? And did my class on the whiteboard. No problems. I went away again. Went home. I came back the next day. Somebody had took a permanent marker and wrote some profanity on the whiteboard. I says, oh, that's no problem. I'll do like I did before. Because the whiteboard represents the clean. I was cleaned out. But you remember the story of the man whose house was swept and clean?
Yes.
And then the evil one came in.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, seven worse.
Seven more.
Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, no problem. I took my eraser, dry eraser, and tried to erase it. It wouldn't come off.
Mm-mm.
Mm-mm. Couldn't do it. I said, no, what am I going to do? And I took the board home. All right. Now I'm in between my vision and real life.
Mm-hmm.
Because this actually happened with the whiteboard, and I took the board home and I tried to find everything I can in the kitchen to wipe that permanent marker off. Mm-hmm. Couldn't find nothing. I mean, soap and bleach, you name it, nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And the Lord said, look under the sink. And under my sink was a bottle of Shout. You remember that spray called Shout, that cleanser? Mm-hmm. And I took that Shout and dabbed it with the towel and I wiped it one time and that magic marker, whatever that was, permanent marker came clean. He says, okay. That's your life right there.
Mm.
In order to get clean, you got to shout it out.
Shout it out.
And I began to write my songs and I began to get emotional about the Lord in my shouts. And here's my show. I'm boldly shouting and proclaiming his name.
Good.
I'm going to play this song by Malcolm Williams and Great Faith. from the In Your Glory album. It's called I Repent. Mm-hmm. They from Chicago.
Yes. Yes.
Michael Williams.
Yes.
I think Janice.
Yes, she is.
Janice.
Jackson.
Jackson sings with them and a few other people from Chicago. Mm-hmm. I Repent. Malcolm Williams. Estelle Keeter and Marilyn Keeter. They're coming in. So are the Jones Show.
No, did you miss part of today's show? Well, just head to Spreaker.com. That is Spreaker, Spreaker.com, and type in the Sir Walter Jones Show to get today's episode and past ones. So do it now.
Done something I never should have done. you just don't even want to say the things that you're dealing with.
Malcolm Williams in Great Faith, in his Glory album, I Repent. This is a great song right here in Chicago. Just something that help you. He says, I want to be right. Keep that up, Britt. Mm-hmm. I want to be right. And this is something that everybody should be really focusing on, the righteousness of God. It is the righteousness of God that gets you out of a lot of turmoil, the inner things that you feel. Yeah, you're going to have some struggles in your life. That comes. Because many who are living right will have those struggles. Don't think because you got saved that all your problems are going to stop. In fact, some problems begin. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Keeters are here, and I just want to open up with a word of prayer. God, we thank you for your presence and your blessings that you've given us through your son, Abraham. He is the father of many of the nations that you've promised him, and we are the seed of him. Yes. And so, God, because of the promises you gave him, we hold our hands up and receive the promise as well.
Yes,
we hold our hands out, and many of the praises of the Hebrew praise terminologies that we've been preaching and teaching, God, we apply that here today with the Yodah and the Todah and the Shabbat and all of these things that you have given us the freedom to do. Mm-hmm. The teachings are going to go forth across the airways. God, I want the people who are listening to adhere to the teaching.
Yes.
That it may not fall on brick.
Yes.
But that the ground is fertile and that it reproduces good fruit. God, I thank you for those who are here who will teach the word of God, and that we might focus on prayer and focus on repentance.
Yes,
we ask this in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
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 The great Estelle Keeter is here, and Marilyn. And Marilyn, go ahead, introduce your mom.
I knew you were going to
come
say
on
that.
Now. That's the way we do it. That's the way we do it.
Thank you, Elder. God bless you. This is Pastor Keeter. And Pastor was called and ordained as a pastor in 1980.
Wow.
A year later, Pastor Keeter started the educational portion of the church ministry, Rescue Missionary Christian School, with grades kindergarten through eighth. And later on, the prophetic anointing was given to her by the Holy Spirit, and she has been exercising that gift ever since.
Wow.
In addition to Pastor being a pastor, a prophetess, a teacher, she is also a chaplain as well as a counselor. So that's Pastor in a very short short.
But
she didn't want anything long. Just
good.
Keep it short.
Good, because y'all already knew I was going to make you do that. Nobody knows them like you. Knows her like you. Y'all are like best friends.
We are.
I can tell.
Mm-hmm,
yeah,
mm-hmm.
When you go hot, she go chew.
Is it that obvious?
Is that so obvious? And you look alike too.
Praise
by
God.
The way. Yeah, God. Yeah. And I went to, I met them last year, January?
January.
Went to a Black History program.
Mm-hmm.
In
February.
In February.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an amazing night. The children were just, good Lord. If you guys listen to some of the posse who comes on our show, Art Lewis and Abby Lewis, their child is one of the students.
Yes.
At the school.
Mm-hmm.
And then we also had a couple of parents on the show.
You sure
we did the interracial show.
Mm-hmm.
What's the name of
the Cullens, Greg
Cullens,
and Krista Cullens.
Cullens. That's right. They were on the show.
Yes.
So we are a wonderful, happy family. We are definitely a happy family here. The Great Rescue Missions Center Church and school. We live in Chicago. Why don't you go by there and visit them? They're in a new building, and
Amen.
The Lord has blessed them from
Amen.
Moving out of a building that you guys were in for what, 30 Ooh, how
30
many
years?
30 years at the same location.
30 years, yes.
Around 78th or something like that in King Drive. And now they're on 77th and Eberhardt.
Yes, 7740 South Eberhardt.
Yeah.
In
yeah.
the former school, St. Dorothy School.
St. Dorothy School.
Right.
Yeah. Your mom leaned back on the chair and said, "Woo."
Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
It was an exodus.
Waiting to exhale.
Yes.
For 30 years. Wow.
Wow.
Well, Pastor, help me out here. The Lord had put repentance on my heart last year.
Okay.
And that should be like the center, the nucleus of our lives as it pertains to 2016. And then I received a call from Marilyn, and she said that the Lord put it on your heart to talk about prayer and repentance. Okay. Why do you think this is so important?
Well, first of all, repentance, to repent before God. I want to say So, Walter, that before there can be any really repentance, there has to be a love for God.
A love.
Mm-hmm. When the Lord called me as a pastor, he told me to tell my people to fall in love with me. Fall in love with me. And so when you fall in love with him and you love him with all your heart, your soul, your mind, your strength, you seek those things to please him.
First commandment.
You seek those things that please him. You want to be obedient because he is Father.
Wow.
Amen.
So that's why the precursor of love is first.
Love, love.
Because if you love something or someone,
yes,
you were treated according to your measure of love, right?
You're going to do that.
Yeah.
Because you love them.
Mm-hmm.
When you really, and that's why he said, tell them to fall.
Fall.
In love with me.
Yeah.
Because then we are not just doing, obeying him because it's just been down.
Right.
We are obeying him because, Father, I love you.
That's something.
Truly love you.
So when a man or a woman falls in love with each other, they fall in love. And I think it's a wonderful way to put this because we recognize that term, falling in love.
Falling in love.
Yeah.
Right.
And then when we fall in love with each other, we act a certain way, don't we?
You do.
Yeah. Yeah.
You do. We do. And that's why Jesus command, he said, love the Lord thy God with all, not some of your love.
Right.
Well, with all your heart.
Yeah. Yeah.
With all your soul, with all your might.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
Love him.
Mm-hmm.
And to fall in love with him.
Mm-hmm.
My grandmother taught me about him being my father at 10 years old. And from that time on, I always call him father. Because I have that father-daughter relationship with him.
Good.
And that's what we have to have in order to be obedient, is to have that kind of relationship, father-daughter relationship, father-son relationship with him. Then when we have that, then the spirit of our father can talk to his children. He talked to us because we listen, because we have his spirit, and we love him.
Wow.
I don't like to do something to displease him, even though I have.
Absolutely.
We all have.
We all have.
But when I do, and when I did, he always corrected me. And I always repented, Father, I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
In the name of Jesus, I am so sorry. Forgive me. And I really feel in my years of experience with him, well, we can come boldly before him and repent because he is a father. He is our father.
Right.
He is our father. He chastens us.
Like our natural father.
Like our natural father. Because he is our father.
Right.
And when we can sit down and we can talk to him as a daughter, and we can tell him anything we need to tell him, Father, I had a really crummy day today, and I know I acted up. I said things I shouldn't have. But Father, I'm so sorry.
So we don't have to use big words as we see come across from mankind, okay?
No.
We can talk to him like you and I talk, right?
We can talk to him sweeping the floor,
you
washing dishes, because our mind should, we should always be in a prayer mode.
Right.
You know, if someone, you ask someone to pray for you and they say, well, let me get, I got to, let me prepare. Then you don't need that person to pray for you. You know, don't pray for me. You got to prepare.
You got to prepare.
Because you should, your mind should always be
in
prayer.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes. That's what I said at the beginning of the show.
Always in prayer.
Yeah. Hey, Bridget, do you have falling in love with Jesus on, what did I call you?
You call me Bridget.
Oh, I haven't called you Bridget in a long time. It should be, you should be honored.
Oh, no.
Yeah, falling in love with Jesus with by I forgot his name. It'll come to me in a minute. He's a jazz Jonathan something.
It's in there.
It's in there. Okay, yeah, yeah. That's a good one that to go into 5 o'clock or 5:30. One of those two. Huh. So, Pastor, the repentance part. Let's talk a little bit more about that. What does it mean?
What it means, it means to go before the Lord. Go before your Father in the name of his Son. And ask for forgiveness. also to say, Father, things that I don't know, my presumptuous sins, things that I'm not.
That's good.
That I no idea.
That's good.
Holy Spirit, bring it back to my remembrance.
That's a good point. Stuff that I don't know.
I don't know.
Wow.
Bring it back to me so that I can ask for forgiveness because I am sorry.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to be really sorry, not like people say, I'm sorry. You know, like sometimes if the kids get into a little whatever and you say to the child, tell him you're sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And he looks at the child and goes, sorry. Well, you know. You were not sorry,
no.
Right? You know, sorry, I said I'm sorry.
Said I'm sorry.
Yeah, but but when you can actually go before him and talk. Mm-hmm. See, the thing about our Father is he said to me once, if only my children would talk to me.
Wow.
If only they would talk to me.
So we don't talk to him. We in church and everybody's talking to the Lord and we talking. And he don't hear about it. He don't hear from us all week, do we?
No. He wants to communicate with us.
Does that mean that that's because that's a lack of relationship we have with him? Because we only talk to him on Sunday or Saturday, depending on where you serve.
We just need to find, like he tells us to go in our closet and pray.
Mm-hmm.
We just need to find that time.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And say, Father, I come to talk. To talk to you.
Just
talk we need to talk.
We need to talk. I like that. Father, we need to talk.
We need to talk.
We need to talk. You know, men don't love, men hate when a woman say that to them.
Okay.
Right.
We need to talk.
Right.
But I love that because if a woman's in love with a man, mm-hmm. she always wanted to talk to him.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
I think that's the perfect analogy you keep bringing about to fall in love with me first. Because
yes.
if you're loving me, you want to, you know how you used to do when you were dating, you'd be on the phone. And just,
all the time.
And be breathing.
Yeah all the time. All the time.
Just silence but be breathing. Right. You hang up for no,
right.
you hang up.
Right. You don't want to hang up.
Yeah, you don't want to hang up. Mm-hmm. So you're so involved in each other.
Definitely.
That's the relationship God is looking for, huh?
That's mm-hmm. that's the relationship he's looking for.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, if only my children
yeah.
would talk to me.
Talk to me.
Not just bless me and
right.
us and three more and however.
And no more.
No more. And you know. But just come and just talk to me.
Mm-hmm.
Because he says, I know what you have need of.
Yeah.
Even before you ask me, I know what you have need of.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know, so instead of begging him,
right.
you know, just like, I want a new pair of gym shoes. Mm-hmm. I want.
Uh-huh.
Why can't you just go to him and say, Father,
right.
we right. need to talk.
Yes.
We need to talk. You know.
That's some good stuff right there. I think you've given us enough foundation to start with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so can we do some Bible study?
Sure.
I want Marilyn to do some reading, and I want you to expound on it because I think this is going to help us, my listening audience, understand that we're not unusual. There, men in the Bible have had the same struggles we've had.
Sure.
So maybe if you could go, because I want to dwell on Psalm 51 in a minute,
mm-hmm.
okay? But before we go there, we need to find out why is David crying out to the Lord the way he is.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you need to start at 2 Samuel chapter 11,
okay.
where it all begins.
Okay.
And then a pastor can help us understand why did David go the route that he did. And this is really going to help us. Second Samuel chapter 11.
Okay, I'm there.
Okay, you can start reading there, and I'll push pastor on this, as I always do.
All right, Second Samuel chapter 11, mm-hmm. and it says, "And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him, and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Reba. Mm-hmm. But David tarried still at Jerusalem."
Okay. Right there. It seemed like that's a problem. Because at the beginning it says all the kings will go to war. He was a king.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But he stayed home. He mm-hmm. stayed home. And I think this kicks off this whole thing with that woman.
Right.
And so let's see where it goes from there.
Okay, continue.
Mm-hmm.
"And it came to pass in an evening tide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. And David sent and inquired after the woman. And one said, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" And David sent messengers and took her, and she came in unto him, and he lay with her. For she was purified from her uncleanness, and she returned unto her house. And the woman conceived, and sent and told David, and said, "I am pregnant."
Help us. I like how you added that word. I am pregnant. Pastor, help us out with this story.
Well, I believe.
Come closer to the mic.
Okay, sorry.
I'm sorry.
Well, I believe that Bathsheba, I believe that she knew that David was going to take his little stroll. I'm not going to put it all on David.
No, I'm glad you said that, because you're speaking the word I speak.
Yeah, no. And David, being a man, even though he was king, he had manly instincts.
Right.
And David had to look really, you know, he liked what he saw.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
And David felt that, I am a king, why not?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I would say that was pride.
Yeah.
Because he knew that she belonged to someone else.
Yeah. Stated it right there that she did belong to someone else.
He knew
that
she belonged to someone else. Mm-hmm. But he was king.
Bam.
He was king.
Mm-hmm.
And he stayed behind for a reason.
Yes, come on.
Okay.
Well, you better keep reading. I got the right teacher in the room.
And David sent to Joab, saying, "Send me Uriah the Hittite." And Joab sent Uriah to David. And when Uriah was come unto David, David demanded of him how Joab did, and how the people did, and how the war prospered. And David said to Uriah, "Go down to thy house and wash thy feet." And Uriah departed out of the king's house, and there followed him a mess of meat from the king. Mm. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord.
Oops.
And went not down to his house. And when they had told David, saying, "Uriah went not down into his house," David said unto Uriah, "Camest thou not from thy journey? Why then didst thou not go down into thy house?" And Uriah said unto David, "The ark and Israel and Judah abide in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of the Lord are encamped in the open fields. Shall I then go into mine house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife? As thou livest, and as thy soul liveth, I will not do this thing."
How was that with Uriah? What kind of man is that?
He loved David.
Wow.
He was loyal to David. Mm-hmm. He truly, truly loved him.
You can see.
Yes.
Yeah.
But did David love him?
Don't look like it.
No. Just tell it like it is. David did not love him.
No.
To him, he was just
trying to cover it up.
He was just a little imp as far as,
absolutely.
You know, he didn't count him high up on the rank.
Right, right.
And he knew that this guy, that Uriah, was not the type of soldier. When he sent him, because you read, when he sent him into that war, he knew that he was not going to make it.
Yeah.
And that was that wrong? Yes. Mm-hmm. That was premeditated.
Right. Yeah. Premeditated. It was.
It was premeditated all the way. You're going to have my wife.
Yeah.
And then you're going to have me killed.
Woo!
Scandal. Oh,
man. You know, we get caught up on TV shows, and we got a book at the house called the Bible.
Right.
It is some of the most interesting, scandalous things that's in this Bible.
Yes.
And we won't even touch it.
Right.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Continue.
Mm-hmm. And David said unto Uriah, "Tarry here today also, and tomorrow I will let thee depart." So Uriah abode in Jerusalem that day and the morrow. And when David had called him, he did eat and drink before him, and he made him drunk.
Mm-hmm.
And at even he went out to lie on his bed with the servants of his lord. but went not down to his house. And it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. And he wrote in the letter, saying, set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle.
Put him on the front line.
And retire ye from him, that he may be smitten and die.
He's guaranteed to die.
Yes.
Because you put him on the front line, and then trust me, because he got that note.
Right.
Putting him on the front line means now don't protect him.
Don't protect him. No.
Yes, that's something. We have to read into that.
Yes,
Don't give him no protection. Once he gets hit, leave him alone.
Let him die.
Let him die.
Yes.
Continue.
And it came to pass when Joab observed the city that he assigned Uriah unto a place where he knew that valiant men were. And the men of the city went out and fought with Joab, and there fell some of the people of the servants of David. And Uriah the Hittite died also. Mm. Then Joab sent and told David all the things concerning the war, and charged the messenger, saying, when thou hast made an end of telling the matters of the war unto the king, and if so be that the king's wrath arise, and he say unto thee, wherefore approach ye so nigh unto the city when ye did fight? Knew ye not that they would shoot from the wall? Who smote Abimelech, the son of Jerubbaal? Did not a woman cast a piece of a millstone upon him from the wall that he died in Thesbis?
Okay, now stop there. Mm-hmm. Go to chapter 12 as we skip a little further to the end. Chapter 12, verse 1.
Okay,
what's it saying here?
Chapter 12 and 1. Uh-huh. And the Lord sent Nathan unto David.
Uh-oh, here we go.
This is the good part. I love this part.
Get your popcorn out.
And he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city.
Okay, Mom. Mm-hmm. Nathan just didn't go to David and says, you're a murderer. Mm-hmm. God gonna kill you. Mm-hmm. He just started telling him a story. Mm-hmm. I mean, why do you think he just started telling him a story?
Well, he did that because when he started telling David that story, the spirit, and David did have the spirit of God on him.
Yeah.
It told him that he was talking. Mm-hmm. You know, he tried to act like, well, that man should be, whoever it is, you know, he should be just stoned. He should just kill him.
Right.
But David knew in his heart.
Yeah.
Through
that story.
Through that story.
Because, you know, y'all Hebrew, a Hebrew like a good story.
Yeah.
Y'all like a good story.
And he was, you know, because the thing about it is spirit can't fool spirit.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
You can't fool spirit. Say, if a man comes in a room and a lady comes in a room, they may not think anybody knows, but because love is a spirit, you're going to know it.
The discerning.
Like that.
It's like game, no game.
You know.
Yeah. Game, no game.
Right.
That's good.
So David knew. David knew.
Yeah.
But he was trying not like he didn't. Oh, yeah, take care of it. But Dave, in his heart.
In his heart.
I'm sure his heart pricked him.
Yeah, yes. Exactly.
I'm sure his heart pricked him.
That's good. And his heart, I told him this, but he still couldn't tell Nathan, I'm that guy, until Nathan turned him on and said, you know what, I'm gonna settle this deal here.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I'm gonna close the sale by saying, okay, bruh, you the one.
Right.
I got to go to this break.
Okay.
Because you got to continue. Wow. You got to keep to continue that when we get back, but. This is good stuff. Again, how could y'all not read? And there's a lot of wonderful stories in the Old Testament. And I know we're a New Testament church. Many of you who are Pentecostals out there, and you dwell in the New Testament, that's good. All right? The Apostle Paul is a wonderful man who have taught us so much. But man, Apostle Paul himself quoted from the Old Testament.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Jesus himself quoted from the Old Testament. And when he was talking to Satan, he said, have you not read? Have you not heard?
It is written.
Okay.
Is written.
And then Satan himself had to quote from the Old Testament. Yes. So how could you throw out all of the foundation of who we really are?
Amen.
You just can't do it.
No. Mm-hmm.
All right. So listen, did you find that song? Okay, let's play it now. Since Pastor brought that up, I had some already in place, but you tossed that out the window. Falling in love with Jesus. And I want to hear a little bit of this and see if y'all can just listen to the wonderful stylings of this man and how he play and sing this song. Falling in love with Jesus. Hope that's what you're doing right now. And we'll be right back with the great Keeters. So on the Jones Show.
This is the Sir Walter Jones Show.
And foolish,
she said it.
That's your drop.
Though it may seem to me.
Oh no! Did you miss part of today's show? Well, just head to Spreaker.com. That is Spreaker, Spreaker.com, and type in the Sir Walter Jones Show to get today's episode and past ones. So do it now.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. Oh yes, oh yes, oh yes, falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus, falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I've ever done. In his arms I feel protected. In his arms never disconnected. No, no. In his arms sing with me this evening. Can I hear you sing it? Sing it with me tonight. Come on, say it.
Falling in love,
amen,
with Jesus.
Oh, sing it.
Falling in love.
Come on, can you stand up and sing with me tonight?
The best thing I've ever done.
the beacon. There is no place, there is no place, there is no go. Let us above the well, there's no place we'd rather be, Lord.
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Falling in love with Jesus by the great Jonathan Kenneth Butler. Mm-hmm. That was on the Kirk Whalum project. I've got both of them, and my goodness, it's some good, easy listening, yet inspirational. If you into, we used to listen to WNUA 95.5 here in Chicago. It's smooth jazz, they call it. But then Kirk Whalum came on the scene and gave something to us who love gospel music. The Gospel According to Jazz, it's called. Chapter 2, and that was Jonathan Butler. Hey, got Kim Burrell on there, George Duke, and quite a few people on that particular album. So if you don't have it, you need to go out and get it. It's really inspirational. Indeed. Falling in love with Jesus
yes.
was the best
Amen.
Thing I've ever done.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. I got him going here. Got him going here. Boy, I'm popular in the room today. Okay, so 2 Samuel chapter 12, we started to read, and Nathan is getting ready to give David a wonderful little story of a conviction.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What does it say?
Okay, did you want me to start over?
Why not?
At one?
Yeah.
And the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him, and he said unto him, there were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. Mm-hmm. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing. Say one little lamb, which he had bought and nourished up, and it grew up together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup and lay in his own bosom and was unto him as a daughter.
Ain't that something? What?
Wow.
There is no better story.
Wow.
Than this.
Yes.
As it pertains to David.
Yes.
By this time, he getting it. Like Mother says, David is getting this.
Yes, he is.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
continue.
He is.
Mm-hmm.
And there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was coming to him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said to Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that has done this thing shall surely die.
Pause. Doesn't sometimes our anger is just an outward expression of our guilt?
Yes.
And I think that's what happened
there. He was trying to cover it up.
Cover it up.
Mm-hmm. He was trying to cover up. Mm-hmm. So, Walter, in my ministering to people, and I remember when the Lord called me as a prophetess. And when he called me as a prophetess, I said, oh, okay. You know, I really didn't understand all the fullness of it and what it meant. And so I studied around and said, oh, okay. And the Lord said to me, he says, when I tell you to do something, you do it.
Mm-hmm.
And when I tell you to say, you say.
Mm-hmm.
So it didn't seem hard,
mm-hmm.
you know. So, okay, I got my first trial. I blew it. I messed it all up. And what happened is this man was at the hospital, a friend of my husband, and he called and he asked me, he said his wife was at work and he had no way of getting home. And he asked if my husband, Keeter, could come to the hospital to get him. And so while I was talking to him, the Lord said to me, tell him to repent of his sins, or he would die. And I'm like, I can't tell that man that.
Lord,
that. How long can you stay on the phone? Okay. I'm like, I happen to call you. Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so my understanding is that they said that he was at the phone. He was talking to me. He left the phone and he went to the machine to get a pop up. The man fell dead.
Mm.
And that bothered me and said, Lord,
I
don't want this man blood on my hands.
Yes. Jesus.
I'm so sorry I messed that up.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm so sorry I was scared.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, Nathan wasn't scared. He just told him.
Yeah.
But they put fear.
Yeah.
You know, if you tell somebody, you know, the Lord told me to tell you to repent or you will die.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, it's in your first time of doing
man.
It. You know, it's like, mm-hmm. how do I say this? Say
right.
How this is going to come out. Uh-huh. What is? I mean, you got all these uh-huh. other things going in your mind. And that was my first time.
Yeah.
So I blew it.
Yeah.
But I promised the Lord. Mm-hmm. I said, Lord, give me another chance. Yeah. I'm so sorry. Mm-hmm. And then from that day to this day,
yeah.
whatever the Lord tells me,
yeah.
I will do it.
Mm-hmm.
I've told people what the Lord has told me. They have went off.
Mm-hmm.
They whatever. But what the Lord told them, mm-hmm. it happened.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It happened.
It happened. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
yeah. I remember I told this lady, the Lord told me to tell her, repent. And she says, I go to church every Sunday.
That's
I go to church
mm-hmm.
every Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Why would the Lord have you to tell me this?
Mm-hmm.
I said, I don't know you. Mm-hmm. I know of you, but I don't know you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't believe the Lord would tell you to tell me this. Okay, fine. About 2 weeks later, her boyfriend, I said again,
mm-hmm.
came home. You just said something about fornication.
Mm-hmm.
Her boyfriend came home
mm-hmm.
and found her dead.
Mm.
But God had given her a warning.
Mm-hmm.
Repent
mm-hmm.
of what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Repent.
Mm.
And so the Lord is crying out to the church, to whoever's listening. I'm your father. Mm-hmm. Come to me. Talk to me.
Yeah.
Get it, whatever you're doing, get it right.
Mm-hmm.
I've already sent the blood sacrifice for you.
Yeah.
All you have to do is to come to me. Talk to me as your father.
Right.
Be washed of whatever you're doing. You know, repent.
Right.
In Revelations, he said, repent.
He sure did.
Repent.
He did.
There is something that's coming upon this earth. We have the choice to repent or rush into judgment.
Right. Yeah.
And the way the world is going, mm-hmm. it's like we're rushing into judgment. You know, God don't want to, I mean, he don't want to kill us.
No.
Mm-mm.
Because he loves us. If he wanted to just kill us, we'd been all dead a long time
amen,
ago.
Amen, amen.
And this is why he's saying to us, pray.
Yeah.
Repent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I came to give you life and life more abundantly.
Right.
Why won't you take it?
Take it.
Mm-hmm. Take it. Mm-hmm. Repent. You know what you're doing is wrong.
Yes. Mm.
You already know it's wrong.
Yeah, most people do know.
You know.
Even the world knows.
Yes.
What they do is wrong.
What yeah. they do is wrong.
They know it as well. Absolutely. Wow, that's a good interjection there.
But we try to cover ours up.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
Well, we have to save face.
Right.
Because they're looking at us as being,
mm-hmm.
because that's what the woman said, right to the church defense.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I go to church.
Mm-hmm. Every Sunday.
Every Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And she probably work in the church.
Mm. But she probably did.
Yep. You know what I'm saying? Continue with that.
Okay. I think we started, let's see, 7.
Okay.
And Nathan said to David, thou art the man.
You him.
Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I anointed thee king over Israel.
This is my favorite part of this story.
Wow. And I delivered thee out of the hand of Saul.
I did all these things for you.
I gave thee thy master's house,
man.
Thy master's wife, mm-hmm. into thy bosom.
Oh.
I gave thee the house of Israel and of Judah.
Mm-hmm.
And if that had been too little,
I would
moreover have given unto thee such and such things.
That part is like taking a knife and stabbing you right there in the heart. He says, if you wanted some more,
mm-hmm.
I could have given it to you.
Yep.
I've heard my own natural father tell me that.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the worst mm-hmm. punishment I ever got. Not the beating. It's mm-hmm. when he said, if you wanted it, I would have given it to you. Mm. But I was too afraid to ask. Mm-hmm. All you had to do is ask me, I could have given it to you. And all the stuff I went through would have been reverted.
Right.
If I could just ask.
Ask.
Wow. That's what God is saying now. If you wanted it, all you had to do is ask me. Mm-hmm. I'd give it to you. Continue.
Wherefore hast thou despised the commandment of the Lord to do evil in his sight? Thou hast killed Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and hast taken his wife to be thy wife, and hast slain with him the sword of the children of Ammon.
And what chapter, what verse are you?
I just read verse 9.
Okay, go to 13.
Okay.
See what David says.
All right, verse 13. Mm-hmm. And David said unto Nathan,
what?
I have sinned against the Lord.
Bam.
And
he waited all this time. Mm-hmm. Finally. Mm-hmm. He says, I've sinned. Mm. Sometimes it takes us years to get to this place when we could have saved all of that wasted time.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And Nathan said unto David, what? The Lord also has put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die.
No.
He probably felt like it or wanted to.
You see everything prior to that. Mm-hmm. It's hardcore for us to say, oh my, this is horrible. But mm-hmm. then you mm-hmm. see how once he did that, mm-hmm. Nathan says, okay, don't fear though. I got you.
Right.
I got you. You mm-hmm. won't die.
Right. Right.
You know, mm-hmm. that should be more encouragement than mm-hmm. anything. Mm-hmm. The fact that you think that your father's getting ready to beat you mm-hmm. to death. mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But God turns around and says, no, don't worry. No. I'm going to let you live.
Yeah.
Because mm-hmm. David cherished his life.
He did.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I got to do some stuff, though.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
And here it comes right here. Here it comes.
How bet, because uh-huh. by this deed thou hast given great occasion to the uh-huh. enemies of the Lord to blaspheme.
Great occasion.
Uh-huh. The child also that is born of thee
uh-huh.
shall surely die.
David loved that boy. So he had to take something that he loved so dearly.
Yes. Uh-huh.
It's like taking a video game uh-huh. from an 11-year-old.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Or a 40-year-old, because a lot of them 40-year-olds playing.
Mm-hmm.
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 Yeah. What else?
It says, and Nathan departed unto his house, mm-hmm. and the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare mm-hmm. unto David, and it was very sick.
Yeah.
David therefore besought God for the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And the elders of the house arose and went to him to raise him up from the earth. But he would not, neither did he eat bread with them. And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died. And the servants of the Lord feared to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, behold, when the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he be then vexed in with himself if we tell him that the child is dead? And when David saw that his servants whispered, David perceived that the child was dead.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, yeah. David said unto his servants, is the child dead?
Mm-hmm.
And they said,
yep.
He is dead.
He gone.
Then David arose from the earth, washed, mm-hmm. anointed himself, mm-hmm. changed his clothes, mm-hmm. and came into the house of the Lord in worship. And he came to his own house. Mm-hmm. And when he required, they set bread before him. And he did eat.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he had to return back to where he was. He says, yes. You know, I don't need me crying over spilled. I got my punishment.
Yes.
And it didn't end there, because then God says, and that yeah. sword.
Oh, wow. Will not leave your never house. Leave your house.
Never leave your house.
Yeah. Mm-mm.
And as you read his story, you'll see this is so true.
Definitely.
His kids went crazy.
Yes.
They did.
Yes.
They did. Buck wild.
Yes.
Now, here comes mm-hmm. Psalms 51.
Okay.
Yes.
He begins to repent. Some of the greatest words
mm-hmm.
I've ever seen written of repentance.
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody who's ever sinned should read this.
Yes.
And that means everybody, because everybody sinned.
Oh, yes.
But, Sir Walter, mm-hmm. don't you think that Father treats us? I mean, he is our Father. And when we do wrong, he does chasten us.
He does. Absolutely.
No, he does.
Yeah.
Because he is Father.
Yes.
He is our Father. And I think that when we begin to... Mm-hmm.
Come to that, Mike. Yeah.
When mm-hmm. we begin to see him mm-hmm. to as a Father,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I think what is that scripture? The beginning of
the
wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like when your mom or your dad told you something, and it's in the back of your mind. Now, if I do this,
that's good.
My mom's going to kill me.
Yeah.
You know,
right.
Because you have a sense of knowing that there, what you doing, there's a consequence. Mm-hmm.
You know the law.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
You know what Father said.
Yeah.
Now, you go on and do this, you're not getting away with it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You're not going to even get away with it.
Yeah.
Just like when Mama used to say, when I get you,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to get you for thus and so.
Yeah.
And when she did take
shit.
The switches, she reminded me, you know, I told you I was going to get
you. I told you.
Because you did thus and so. You thought you got away with it, didn't you? But you didn't.
Ooh, what a great analogy.
You didn't get away with it.
You didn't get away with
you
it.
You didn't. But when she did get you, she got you for that, which you thought you got away with.
Right? Ah, wow.
But you knew in the back of your mind
you
that she didn't forget.
Yeah. Yeah,
man. You know, and so that's how our Father is.
Same way.
Because he said, he who formed the eye, shall he not see?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He planted the ear, shall he not hear?
Right,
amen.
Right.
So, you know, you're not getting away with anything.
No, absolutely.
You know? So it's best to be obedient.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Do what Father says. I mean, because he is our Father.
Right. Mm-hmm.
To do what he says, do love him, first of all.
Mm-hmm.
You have to love him in order to obey him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I love him, so I obey him.
Phew.
Because I don't want no whoopings.
I don't want no whoopings.
I'm too old for some whoopings. I don't want no whoopings.
What the book say?
Psalms 51.
Yes.
Have mercy upon me, O God.
Have mercy.
According to thy loving kindness.
Yes, Father.
According unto the multitude of thy tender mercies. Mm. Blot out my transgression.
Thank you for the blood, Lord.
Loving kindness. He says it's according to your loving kindness, which is huge. You can't even put a number on God's loving kindness.
You can't.
And then he says, then, but your mercies are tender.
Yes.
tender mercies.
Tender mercies.
Mm-hmm. What a description.
Yes.
This is better than any Shakespeare writ I've ever. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Next one.
He says in verse 2, wash me thoroughly from my iniquity.
Yes, Lord.
And cleanse me from my sin.
Thank you for the blood.
And
you know it's the difference between iniquity and sin.
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
You better teach.
You know, when we sin against God, we come against, you know, his law, his commandment.
Right.
But iniquity is the wickedness of it.
Mm.
You know, it's just, for an example, it's like a crime.
Mm-hmm.
A person can commit a crime, but it can be a heinous crime.
Yeah.
And that is the iniquity of it.
Yeah.
And if we cross that over with David, you know, not only did he think evil in his heart against Uriah, because as Pastor was saying, he was premeditating this whole thing.
Yeah, he was.
But by having him put on that front line knowing that he was going to die, that was iniquity.
There was.
So he's telling God here, you know, wash me all the way through of all the wickedness of even the sins that I have committed.
Hmm.
I know that they're not right before you.
Wow. All right.
To be able to talk to Father like that, you know.
To be able to talk to him.
Be able to talk to him. And we can, no matter what we have done, we can, as a children of his, we can, the beautiful part, we can just talk to him.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to be afraid to talk to him.
No.
Because he said, come boldly
before
him.
Before.
And just talk to him. Yeah. I mean, he's a loving Father.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's good. Mm-hmm. Good stuff. Continue.
Verse 3, for I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Yes. Mm-hmm. He's honest now.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. He said, I know what I did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know what he did.
Mm-hmm.
Against thee,
thee only,
have I sinned.
Amen.
Now, people bring this up, and they usually pause here. They says, well, didn't you sin against Bathsheba as well?
Mm-hmm.
I love how he says this.
Mm-hmm.
He says, if he was talking to his brothers or men, I sinned against Bathsheba as well.
Mm-hmm.
But the end result is,
right,
I sinned against God and God
only. Amen.
That's right.
Because he's the creator of me.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And so I have to focus on him.
Mm-hmm.
And after I focus on repenting to him, all this other stuff is going to have to fall in place.
Exactly. Right.
You know, but get it right with him, because you guys can forgive me.
Right.
But how strong is your forgiveness compared to God's forgiveness?
Amen. Mm-hmm. Oh,
Yeah, he went straight to it.
Oh, yes.
Oh, that's good stuff. Go, continue.
And done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified. I got to turn the page. Mm-hmm. When thou speakest, and be clear when thy judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity.
Uh-oh.
And in sin did my mother conceive me.
He taking it back to the foundation. Yes. Mm-hmm. My in sin.
Mm-hmm.
My mama.
Mm-hmm. Mama.
Mm-hmm. My mama. Mm-hmm. Yeah, put his mama in this.
Okay. His mama was it?
It sure was. Yes. Continue.
Behold, thy desire is truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part, thou shalt make me to know wisdom.
Amen.
Purge me with hyssop,
yes,
and I shall be clean.
Mm-hmm.
Wash me, mm-hmm, and I shall be whiter than snow.
Hyssop is a healing agent.
Yes.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And he's now mm-hmm he's using this in a symbolic.
Yes.
You know, the spiritual hyssop. Mm-hmm. That's why I say this is so poetic justice
mm-hmm
here.
Mm-hmm.
But and the other Hebrew readers, they understand this language.
Yes.
They know.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They understand when he bring out things like this. Continue.
Make me to hear joy and gladness,
yeah,
that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice.
Wow.
Mm. Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities.
Mm.
And then this is the part here.
Here it is.
Yes, yes.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
Renew a right spirit in me. Steadfast.
Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
Oh, my God.
Can you imagine?
I can't imagine.
Being in darkness,
yes,
and then the Holy Spirit not even being with you.
Mm-mm.
Can you imagine that?
Mm-mm. No.
That is a place of torment.
Oh. Yes, yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Place of torment.
Yes.
You can't even fathom that feeling.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Man can leave you. Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Because
mm-hmm
God says, I'll never leave you.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So you have some type of light there. You have you have the light.
Mm-hmm.
But he gone?
Oh, no, Lord.
No.
Goodness. You can't talk to him.
You can't.
No.
Oh. <Mm-mm.
laughs> And that's what happened to King Saul.
Saul,
yes. Yeah. No. The prophet stopped talking.
Oh, yes.
Everybody stopped talking. He's let me go get a witch. Because ain't nobody talking to me.
Right.
Oh, God.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Elder, how empty Saul was.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
Not having that, you know,
mm-hmm,
being able mm-hmm to have that communication.
Oh, wow.
And that's empty. What sin does. It separates us from God.
It does.
Ooh-wee.
To be separated from my Father.
Yes.
Oh, Lord.
To be separated. Hey, Bridget. What's your name again?
No,
sir.
Okay,
sir. I like that. This go to James Moss as we go to this last break of the evening. Just play 2 minutes of this song. Just 2 minutes, because this is getting good right here. This is called Restored. After you've done all this wonderful repenting, God can restore you back to the place where you left.
Amen.
Okay, if a brother has been caught in a fault, mm-hmm, ye who are spiritual,
yes,
restore.
Yes.
And then he says, now, when you do this, please consider yourself. Unless you also be tempted. Mm-hmm. All right. So restore people. Restoration is so wonderful.
Yes, it is.
When you get back into the wonderful graces of either people or
mm-hmm
God,
mm-hmm,
God.
And then you look back and see what you've done,
mm-hmm,
and now you into that wonderful, back to that seat.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the whole prodigal son situation is all about. It's like his brother got mad at him. Got mad at the father, that is.
Yes.
How you gonna bring that boy back in there and give him all this great stuff?
Mm-hmm.
I think that's another mm-hmm wonderful story.
Mm-hmm.
Who don't read the Bible? What's wrong with y'all? James Moss, Restored. Listen to this song right here. Came out 2009. We're coming right back with the magnificent teachings of the Keeters. So Wallace Jones Show.
No, did you miss part of today's show? Well, just head to Spreaker.com. That is Spreaker, SPREAKER.com, and type in the Sir Walter Jones Show to get today's episode and past ones. So do it now.
I'm restored and I've been rewarded. I'm redeemed from guilt and shame. Never rejected, just reconnected. Now I'm exalted because I know his name. Thank you for my storm. I'm restored and I've been rewarded. I'm redeemed from guilt and shame. Never rejected, just reconnected. Now I'm exalted because I know his name.
I like this part right here. It's all over. You gotta believe it. God said it. Oh, listen, I'm healed and rebuilt and restored. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. You gotta believe it. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I'm restored and I've been rewarded. Just reconnected, and now I'm exalted because I know his name. Come on, take it up.
I'm restored. Oh, yeah. And I've been rewarded.
I've been redeemed.
There's no more guilt and shame. Never.
I'm restored. The great Jay Moss from Detroit, Michigan. Y'all, that's the Clark sisters' nephew. Them Mosses, he in the family. He, Manny Moss Clark's brother's son or something like that. Yeah, there you go. Mm-hmm. Facebook has chimed in, and man, they're going strong. Y'all usually go back and forth with Facebook. Riley Jones, I wish he was up in here because he's giving us some wonderful questions here, and hopefully he'll answer them on Facebook. Answer them on Facebook, man. He asked a question. This was David related to Nathan? Yes. Next question. Eric Drew Hayes says, reading a book now called Peacemaker by Ken Sand that would fit this theme perfectly. The great Eric Drew Hayes from Indianapolis. I didn't, brother Rodney asked three more questions. I think he must be Hebrew. That's my brother, by the way. He must be Hebrew because he asked these questions. He said, David broke three of the Ten Commandments when he did this. This is so true, and I wish we had time to go into that. He also asked a question, which was worse, the having sex with the man's wife or the killing of the man by setting him up to be killed by the enemy? Another great question.
Yes, it is.
And then he says, I don't think he sinned against Bathsheba because as king, he had a right to do what he did. This is what Samuel told Israel. All right. Now, put those questions, I mean, the answers, Rodney, on the comments down there so that we can read them on the air so that we can challenge you. Okay. All right. Where we are again, we got to read this real fast because I want to go to the last Bible
verse.
We're
on 12.
Uh-huh.
Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation.
Take me back to it.
Mm-hmm.
That's what restore means.
Mm-hmm.
I'm restored.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. No, go for it.
And uphold me with thy spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee.
He says, after that, then I will do this.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God.
Yeah.
Thy God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of thy righteousness.
Ooh.
O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise.
Mm.
For thy desireth not sacrifice,
mm-mm,
else would I give it.
I read that in first, what's that, Isaiah, when
yes,
we opened up a show.
Yes.
God says, you know, I don't need all that sacrifices.
Mm-hmm.
If this
yeah
is where your heart
yeah
is,
yeah,
I don't
yeah
want it.
Yeah.
He said, if it was required, I give it.
Right.
You just read that.
Yes.
Go ahead, read that again.
He said in verse 16, uh-huh, for thou desireth not sacrifice.
Don't want it.
Else would I give it. Thou delightest not in burnt offerings.
Oh, boy.
The sacrifices of God are a broken
ooh
spirit.
That's the greatest amen sacrifice.
Yes, it is.
Broken.
Yes.
Brokenness. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. A broken and a contrite heart, O yeah God, thou would not despise.
Wow.
do good in thy good pleasure unto Zion. Build thou the walls of Jerusalem.
Yeah.
Then shalt thou be pleased with the sacrifices of righteousness.
Then comes that sacrifice.
Yes.
The sacrifice of what, though?
Righteousness.
Righteousness. Uh-huh.
With burnt offering.
Then it comes.
And whole burnt offering.
Yes.
Then shall they offer bullocks.
There you go.
Upon thy altar.
Uh-huh. And you got to understand that's still during that time of sacrifice, mm-hmm. sacrificial offering mm-hmm. during that time.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the same, and we can apply this to today, our sacrifice of praise.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
God doesn't want to hear all of that.
No. He most certainly
yeah.
does not.
Yes. Yeah. It's all emotional.
It is.
And he's like, you know what? You don't even talk to your husband at home.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You don't even love. You don't need love. You don't know where your children are.
Right.
Oh, you know.
Come on now. And so now you go come to church and start talking about some holy, holy, holy.
Yes.
I don't want to hear none of it. Go home and find your children and love
yes,
them.
Yes. Yes. And go ahead on.
Yep.
Preach.
And go kiss your husband.
Yeah. Right.
Tell him you love him. Cook him a meal every now and then. Yeah. Okay.
Every now and then.
Because you don't cook at all. Y'all all right. go to McDonald's.
Oh,
I know a lot of pastors' wives who do not cook
yeah.
for their husbands.
I believe yeah.
they
yeah,
don't.
They don't.
They do not cook. He says, I don't let him do all that stuff.
Mm.
Like, wow, really? You really? Mm-hmm. But you go to church and you do all this
mm-hmm.
worship.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, and then I think the last thing that comes to play here mm-hmm. is the if my people situation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
So can you go to two places here
okay.
as we wrap this up?
Okay.
Second Chronicles 7:14,
okay.
the usual.
All right.
And then the First Kings. So do First Kings 9:1 first, because in order to do First Kings 9:1, you can understand why God says, "If my people, which are called by my name."
So Walter, I would
yes.
like to say this
mm-hmm.
is that the Lord is saying there are not going to be any changes
mm-hmm.
as far as the killing and all of these things that are going on among our people.
I believe it.
Until our people turn.
Gotta turn.
And come back.
Mm.
And we are the people who can do it
yeah.
through prayer
yeah.
and repentance. There's not going to be a change.
Whew.
There's not. The churches have let the people down.
We can march all we want to.
It's mm. not going to help any.
It's not going to help.
It's not going to help any.
No, it's not. We can do, we can put together gun laws.
Yeah.
So. Right.
All these things, it's not going to help. We can fire police chiefs
yes.
and take down the mayor.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
Yeah, come on. We can do all these things. It's not going to work.
That's what I've Amen. Been saying.
Yeah, we can because when a cancer sets in your body,
mm-hmm.
the doctor got to chase that cancer around the
mm-hmm.
body
mm-hmm.
because he can get rid of it in one place
mm-hmm.
and it will grow somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I call Chicago gangrene.
Mm-hmm.
You got to cut it off.
Right.
That's
yeah.
right.
It's on, that's the only way you're going to save that leg.
Yes.
The other leg.
Because
mm-hmm. you got to cut the other one off. Because if you don't cut it
right
at that disease,
mm-hmm.
it's going to go up into your body and
yes.
go to your brain
yes.
and kill you.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
So that's Chicago. We have gangrene. We have a bad case of cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And we need, what's that stuff? Radiation?
Well, I don't know.
Yeah.
we need radiation treatment or something.
Why are they not telling their people
mm-hmm.
that they need to pray?
Mm-hmm.
You need to repent.
Absolutely.
Your people need this.
Yeah.
Why?
Because
why is that?
I think because the cameras are not,
the
NBC and CBS is not showing up at the church. You see
mm-hmm.
what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's why they're marching because, and all these are pastors who are at the helm,
mm-hmm.
but the cameras are there.
Mm-hmm.
And the camera hungry.
Mm-hmm.
But you mentioned that closet.
Mm-hmm.
Tell your people to, while they're at home,
yeah.
go to the closet.
Mm-hmm.
Go to
mm-hmm.
the closet
yes,
and pray.
Yes, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
That movie, what was it called? What's that movie? War Room?
War Room.
I think if you haven't
Excellent.
Seen it, if
Excellent,
you haven't seen
Lord.
It, mm-hmm. you need to go see that movie
mm-hmm.
because
Definitely.
It really speaks the sentiments of what mm-hmm. we should be doing.
Mm-hmm. Really?
That woman went to the closet for her wayward
mm-hmm.
husband.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't put a finger in his face and told him all the things that you
mm-hmm.
were doing wrong. She just went to the closet.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
God set something in him when he was away. He can mm-hmm. lay with this woman.
Mm-hmm.
And the Spirit spoke.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, this is something. I mean, it just. And it will never get an Oscar.
Mm-hmm.
It won't win an Academy Award
mm-hmm.
because that is the fix.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But we already know why. So do your, go to, what is it?
You said First Kings chapter 9 and 1.
What's that?
And it came to pass when Solomon had finished the building of the house of the Lord.
Now God is speaking to who? Solomon.
Solomon.
Okay, he's speaking to Solomon, mm-hmm. and he's using him as an example for us all.
Yes.
Okay, what did he say?
And the king's house and all Solomon's desires, which he was pleased to do.
Yep, y'all building these churches, dedicated to the Lord. All right, continue.
That the Lord appeared to Solomon the second time, as he had appeared unto him at Gibeon. Mm-hmm. And the Lord said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and thy supplication that thou hast made before me.
Yeah.
I have hallowed this house which thou hast built to put my name there forever, and my eyes and my heart shall be there perpetually.
Yes.
And if thou wilt walk before me.
God keeps saying if.
Yes.
Right? If you walk before me.
You have a choice.
He's giving him a mandate. An ultimatum. That's the word.
That's right. Yes.
Okay. You got the house built. All right. And I'm here. You brought me in. Because remember the smoke came while they was worshiping.
Yes.
All right. That's all Solomon's temple. He says, all right, now let me tell you. Come here, Solomon. I'll tell you something. All right. Now if you do this, what do you say?
And if thou wilt walk before me, as David thy father walked, in integrity of heart.
Yes.
And in uprightness to do according to some, he said, all that I have commanded thee, and will keep my statutes and my judgments,
then
I will establish the throne of thy kingdom upon Israel forever.
Forever. Now, God is a repetitive, meaning he repeats himself. He doesn't have to keep saying new stuff. Because we're looking for new words of God, but we ain't heard the old words.
Right,
absolutely.
Yeah, he says, if, okay. Mm-hmm. Now, you know this is the First Kings, okay?
Yes.
But when you get to Second Chronicles, come on, you know, I already know where I'm going.
Yeah.
Okay, Second Chronicles chapter 7,
yes.
Start with verse 12.
Gotcha.
And see who he's talking to again here.
Okay,
because apparently Solomon must have forgot some stuff.
Yes, he did.
Oh, he forgot a lot.
700 concubines messing with that astral from the evil gods. All right, what did he say?
Wow, okay. Here the Lord confirms the covenant again. He says, and the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven and there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name,
his name,
shall humble themselves.
Okay.
Humble.
Humble. There you go. Okay. Because this is not when you're talking about repentance, it must not be a counterfeit type repentance.
Right.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Dang.
Said I was sorry.
I said I was sorry. Man. Well, forget it then. Okay. But he said, humble.
Humble.
All right. What else?
And pray.
Okay. So that seemed like they went together. Humble and pray.
Yeah.
I think that's one.
Yeah.
Humble and pray.
All
right.
And seek thy face.
Seek. All right.
And turn. Slowly I turn. Step by step.
Now, is this turn 180 or 360?
360. All the way.
If you turn 360, that means you're back at the same spot. You mean 180.
That was a test.
Of the emergency broadcast system?
Yes.
Because if you're going north, and that's the sin direction.
Yeah.
And God is hanging out in the south.
Well, you're going to turn or burn. Turn or burn.
Or burn. Okay. What's next? You turn or burn.
Okay. So after we do all that, we got to turn from our wicked ways.
Wicked ways.
Then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin.
He says, after you do this, then I'm going to hear from heaven.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And then what do you say?
And will heal their land.
So he's going to hear from heaven and then forgive their sins.
Mm-hmm.
He always, no matter what, He have to forgive your sins.
Mm-hmm. He does, yes.
When you do it this way.
Yes.
The humble and pray.
Mm-hmm.
He's got to do it. If he doesn't do it, then you praying to the wrong God.
Yes.
Because my father, I've never known him return. Mm-hmm. I'm talking my natural father. Mm-hmm. I've never mm-hmm. known him return for me mm-hmm. when he realized mm-hmm. My son is humble now.
Yeah.
He got
yeah.
it now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
absolutely.
even my natural father, even if he did not have it, mm-hmm. he went somewhere and borrowed it. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's how much he knew. He said, this boy, he is worthy mm-hmm. of it. Mm-hmm. I got to find a way to get this to him. Mm-hmm. Now, God has everything, so he doesn't borrow nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. All right. Okay, what did it say, sis?
You want me to keep reading?
This
is 15. Now my eyes shall be open, mm-hmm. and my ears attend unto the prayer that is made in this place.
Wow. You see? Now, I love this. He's given a directive to Solomon. And now, Mother, how can we apply this to our lives today? The whole repentance and prayer.
Well, as I said in the beginning, love.
Yeah.
Love will always set you free.
Mm.
And to love God,
uh-huh.
to truly love him. And when you truly love him and there comes something in your life, you don't want it there because you don't want anything between you and Father.
Right.
You know, a natural father, a natural mom, you don't want anything between you two.
Right.
And so you're going to seek that. What you know that's wrong, and the Holy Spirit is so gentle.
Yeah,
he is.
Really,
he is really, really, really.
Yes,
you know he's not. Now sometimes the Lord will, you know, he mm-hmm. will mm-hmm. get you. I mean, I have gone before the Lord with something like, "Lord, blah 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 blah." Oh, no, and the Lord has stopped me and told me, "Be quiet." I go like, "Oh, mm-hmm. another word." Oh, okay, he said. And I mean, it was with a strong voice.
Sure.
You know, the Holy Spirit said, be quiet.
Be quiet. Mm.
You talked enough.
Mm.
You know, I'm like, oh, okay. All right. Because I knew, like, if I said something else, I might have been on the floor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like backhand lick or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I truly believe that when we really love him. And the other thing the two things that he told me, he said, tell my people to fall in love with me. And he said, and I want you to remember, daughter, people are not your source.
Mm.
Wow.
I am your source.
I am your source.
Mm-hmm.
I am your source.
Yeah.
And so I have always believed that God is my source.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The Lord is my shepherd.
The Lord is my shepherd.
He is the shepherd of my life. He is our shepherd. And I believe that the people that are listening today, all they have to do is just to talk to him.
Yeah.
I mean, he's so easy to talk
he
to.
Really is. He
and
really
like you said, you don't have to use fancy words
no.
to talk to him.
No.
You really don't.
You really don't.
You use childlike words.
That's, well, yeah.
Yes.
He would have us come as children.
As yes. children.
Childlike.
Childlike.
Yeah.
Yes.
Can you, Principal, go to Revelation chapter 2? That'd be the last one.
Okay.
Revelation chapter 2. Now, he's talking to, this is Ephesus.
Mm-hmm.
See if we can relate this to maybe our churches today.
Mm-hmm.
As you find that there are 7 counterfeits of repentance, we'll probably have to do this in a part 2. There's always a part 2, part 3, part 4 of this type of show. So
mm-hmm.
you do realize y'all coming back, right? On
yeah,
this subject,
more
do.
Than likely,
yeah. You have to come back because we just, you know, because people always need to repent. So yeah,
amen.
Yeah, but the first one is repentance is not a religious repentance.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody got this culture of being
mm-hmm.
religious.
Mm-hmm.
They, you know, like mm-hmm. Father, forgive me for I have sinned. You know,
right.
like the Catholics do.
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so I'm saying, and then they said number 2, repentance is not pagan repentance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
we have rituals that
mm-hmm.
we do,
mm-hmm.
paganistic. Like
mm-hmm.
and number 3, repentance is not worldly sorrow.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Apostle Paul talked about this worldly sorrow. And this is going to be part two of our show when we get to it. Part number four, the repentance is not mere confession.
Okay.
All right. Oh, yeah, I sinned. All right. Mm-hmm. Okay, now, since I've told him I sinned, I'm good now.
Mm-hmm.
Number five, repentance is not blame shifting.
Yes, definitely.
Shifting the blame.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Like Adam says, this woman you gave me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The woman made me do it.
Yep, and then the woman said, that serpent.
The snake made me do it.
Right.
Number six, repentance is not minimizing. And then number seven, repentance is not excuse making. Okay. Those are the seven things of I want to dwell on part two.
Okay.
When we get to it. Go to Revelation 2. What does it say?
Okay, I'm here, verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write.
That's Pastor Keeter. He's writing to you, Pastor.
These things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand.
Yes.
Who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience and how thou canst not bear them which are evil.
And thou you can't bear them when they're evil.
And thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not.
That's a man. Don't do that on my show. Go ahead.
And has found them liars.
Liars. Yeah.
And has borne and has patience and for my name's sake has labored and has not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee.
I got all against you.
Because thou hast left thy first love.
You keep you keep bringing it home.
Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen and repent.
Remember where you come from.
Yes. And do repent. Thy first works.
Yes.
Or else I will come unto thee quickly.
Yes.
And will remove thy candlestick out of his place. Except.
Yeah.
Thou repent.
You will drop dead if you're not careful.
Thank you.
Yes.
And that's what the Lord said. Mm-hmm. Repent or you will die.
You will die. Whew.
Repent.
Or you will die.
Or you will die.
That's true.
That false prophet that came about, I think it was Jeremiah chapter 28, I think it is. Mm-hmm. His name was Hananiah at the time. Mm-hmm. And he was a false prophet, but he was prophesying some wonderful things. Mm-hmm. And people was like, yay, man. The true prophet was like, amen.
Yeah, he got caught up.
Jeremiah got caught up and said, amen. And then God spoke to the true prophet and says, I didn't send him. Matter of fact, at the end of the week, tell him he's going to be dead.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
And God killed him.
Yes, he did.
And people don't want to hear that, though, Sir Walter.
They don't want to hear it.
You tell them that, they look at you like, God didn't tell you that. Yes, God did tell
you that. Yeah, he did. Proverbs 6:16. Read that real quick as I get up out of here. Proverbs 6:16. Since we always talk about the sins of sex, we hear it in our church so much, and we know that's rampant.
Okay.
And then there's all this other stuff we don't talk about because a lot of y'all are guilty of it. All right. 6:16, what does it say?
These six things doth the Lord hate.
Okay, he hate these six. All right.
Yea, seven are an abomination.
Oh, but seven of them, oh boy.
Unto him.
What?
A proud look.
Proud look. Mm-hmm.
A lying tongue.
You liars.
And hands that shed innocent blood.
Oh, you mentioned that earlier.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. And heart that devises wicked imaginations.
Ooh, your heart does this. Yes.
Feet that be swift in running to mischief.
In and out of people's houses, just trying to destroy families. Yes. Mm-hmm.
A false witness.
You tattletale. You see, you said I did something. Knowing good well, I didn't do it.
Right.
Okay.
That speaketh lies.
You're a liar.
And you said this at the beginning.
What's
and
that?
He that soweth discord among brethren.
God calls all those an abomination. All right. So you can focus on that one sexual sin all you want to, but you better. You Jesus says about the trying to remove that thing out the man's eye, the little twig, and you got a mote in yours.
In your own.
Okay, he says, now remove the mold out your eye, then you can go and remove the twig out that man's eye.
Right.
So all sin is unrighteousness is sin. Mm-hmm. All of it is bad. Mm-hmm. So preach about all of it. Don't just focus on that one.
That's right.
Because you focus on that one, and the devil's going to trick you up.
Amen.
He's going to make you believe that what you're doing is nice, it's good, you're good, you're holy. But your house is in disarray.
Yes.
Disarray. And I know we didn't have time to do this, but then on part two, we'll have to do it. We'll talk about your dedication to your husband before he passed.
Mm.
Pastor Keeter.
Mm-hmm.
Her dedication and love
mm-hmm.
for her family.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I want to talk about some of that stuff because we have people out there in all type of situations.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my grandmother had an unsaved husband
mm-hmm.
for many years,
mm-hmm.
but she loved and respected him. And she lived a holy life
mm-hmm.
and before him so that he can finally get it right.
Yeah.
And then he finally got it right. Mm-hmm. And then he died.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Can we talk about
yes.
that later? All
we
right.
Can, yeah.
All right. All right.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's true.
Let me get me out of here. What's your name? The greatest engineer in the country. thank you, Pastor Keeter. Thank you.
Thank you, Elder.
This is wonderful.
Thank you.
Matter of fact, we should do this once a month. I think y'all should just make this a once a month to keep this on the people's minds.
Amen.
Keep it on their minds.
Amen.
We should do this. We should do a series. Do this once a month. Keep coming back and keep pushing this because people will start forgetting their New Year's mm-hmm. resolutions
oh.
come March.
Oh. Definitely.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand.
This song is called Tomorrow by the Winans, 1984.
Yes.
Wow, what a good year. I was
beautiful
in high school.
Song.
Yes. Listen to the words of this song. If you don't know Christ, I think you need to go and need to listen to this song. Mm-hmm. Hear what he's saying here. Because tomorrow just might be too late.
Oh,
Pastor Keeter
God.
Had witnessed at least two people that died.
More than that.
I see what I'm saying? More than that. Who said, well, you know what? I go to church every Sunday.
Mm.
And they're dead now.
Jesus.
And their eyes were opened in judgment.
Oh, my.
Okay.
Yes.
So don't wait till tomorrow. Give your life today. Thank you, God, for your presence, and thank you for the word that we have just given. This is from your lips.
Yes, Lord.
From your lips. And we're just messengers.
Amen.
And so, God, I thank you for allowing us to be messengers so that people can hear the importance and the power of repentance.
Yes.
But we want to love you.
Amen.
And if we love you, it'd be easy for us to repent.
Thank you,
because
Lord.
We love you and we don't want to hurt you.
Yes. Amen.
Thank you, God. We love you and we want the world to know that you would have all men saved.
Yes.
All of them.
All men saved.
All men saved.
Yes.
And so we want to continue to pray for the peace, not just of Jerusalem, but also the peace yes. of this country.
Yes.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Meet me tomorrow, y'all. Fireside Friday. We've got the great brand will be here to talk about financial stability among the African American family.
Yes.
And current events. Love you. So Walter Jones Show.
And you say, I know, but tomorrow, tomorrow, I'll give my life tomorrow. I thought about today. Oh, but so much easier to say tomorrow.
Hey, ladies and gents, if you missed any of today's show, head to Spreaker.com and search the Sir Walter Jones Show and listen to this show and past shows. Now remember, search for the Sir Walter Jones Show on Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker spelled Spreaker.com. And enjoy.
You have been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show, where Sir Walter Jones provides you with a biblical perspective on everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones at his website, www.sirwalterjones.com. Search the Sir Walter Jones Show on Facebook or follow on Twitter at Sir Walter's Music. Until next time, thank you for listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.
Hi, Mr. Walters.